Hi there, and welcome to Central Texas Gardener. I'm Tom Spencer. The summer heat is on the wane, and we're ready to get back to the garden with new perspectives. If you're looking for ideas, you'll certainly find them on the San Antonio Garden Conservancy Tour. Today, we preview these outstanding gardens. Right now, let's visit one of them.
Viewpoints connect this garden to its home and family. Some are breathtaking and expansive. Others are a meditative whisper. The gardens reflect the hands-on love that owners Kathy and Robert have shared since 1980. But recently, when they needed some help, they relied on Tony Villarreal's garden design expertise.
Drainage has always been a problem on this piece of property because so much drains through here. And two, the deer ate us out of house and home, what can I say? We had a beautiful garden, but through the years they had decided it was quite tasty. They loved the pittosporum and they just peeled everything year after year.
Tony's solutions blended his love of formal structure with Kathy and Robert's aesthetic for a garden to live in.
One of the most important things I look at is the house, the home's architecture, because I think it's so important that the plants relate to it. I think if you have like a landscape that doesn't blend well with the architecture, it's always fighting. And my kind of design I like using and implementing is something that's more harmonious. It's gotta like be easy on the eye, flow well.
The home that was originally here that we tore down about 24 years ago, my husband didn't want to give up a tree, a bush, or a shrub. So we went back on a very similar footprint. And some of that foliage that invites you down the front walk is actually 40 years old.
Tony embellished and enhanced while replacing deer-chomped plants. He creates serenity and connectivity between spaces by clustering and repeating plants. It's through shaping that he promotes movement and attention.
I always like using a very limited amount of plant material because I think it's real important on the eye. I think it's real soothing on the eye. When you have a strong architectural house, I really believe less is more and repeats are really good. This garden is very large, but I didn't want to just have a lot of different little smaller design elements.
He breaks things up with other dimensions.
I saw this blank wall and I looked up and I saw the chimney and I thought, that's it. I'm gonna do these squares on this Mexican brick wall and all it's gonna have is just that beautiful Confederate jasmine on the squared pattern with just a low border of monkey grass. So it's all just like the lawn, the grass, and then the espalier.
To direct the rainfall runoff that threatened the house and garden, Tony designed a naturalistic dry creek bed. Beloved by wildlife, it's also turned an anxious view into a treasured one. Moving to troubled drainage near the house, Tony solved it with a retaining wall that matches the home's old Mexican brick. He gave it safe footing on the way to a private cove that he embellished. Viewed from the kitchen or dining room, it connects the outdoors with what's going on inside.
We love to entertain, and I just think that because our property is large, that brought intimacy to the dining room. You still have the outdoor, and it's beautifully lit at night, and then with the water going, I think it's special.
In back, they also have a choice of views. One is to a canyon and its wildlife. For a closer encounter, they wander the trails they made. Tony gave them a chance to enjoy a view at the side garden's precipice.
I will say that before Tony came, this particular side of the house, the land fell off very rapidly. And so for all of the 30 years I've been here, I couldn't really traverse that side of the property because it was so rocky and dangerous. So when they came in and made these flat spaces that we could enjoy it, and we began to take away some of the foliage that was there, it was just like magic. It just opened up and it has become a very special place to me.
Tony gave definition and accessibility to other difficult areas.
And then there's so many other things when you're in the garden, you know, I consider like the trees, they're so huge, such a huge part of it. The sky, the plains of grass or ground cover, I think that's also another huge element to consider. And so if you've got a lot of different plant materials going on, it almost fights with all that harmony of the natural sense of things.
Kathy and Robert agree with that. Well, sort of.
We have very different ideas on what we like to plant. We've been married 30 years, wonderful years, and probably the only three or four crosswords we've ever had has been over the garden. What he likes, what I like. But it's all meshed together through that time. He really is a gardener. He really wants to grow his vegetables, and he likes bits of color, and I like it more simple, more playing off the green. So I think it has come together in a way that pleases us both, because we both really love to be out here.
Like anything else, gardens are much richer when different viewpoints come together. They go for the bold to combine philosophies in evergreen and seasonal containers.
Because the space is so large, you have to go to a large container. Otherwise, it's just cluttered. You could just clutter with a million different little of this and that. So I think the space itself dictates that you have to have a pretty good sized container and make a show of one thing as opposed to many smaller things.
With his faux bois designs, artist Carlos Cortez anchors the space and unites it with the garden. But what really unites the garden is Kathy and Robert.
We really live in it. I think that's the nicest thing I can say about it. It isn't a garden for show. It's a garden made with love, and there's a lot of love here.
Well, that lovely garden is one of many that will be on the San Antonio Garden Conservancy Open Days tour, a wonderful event for the people of San Antonio and the whole region, and I hope that you'll be among the participants and the people who get out and see that garden. Joining me now is Joann Neal, who has helped organize the Open Days tour in San Antonio. This is the second Open Days tour in San Antonio?
Yes, yes. Well, as you know, 2 years ago, we had the first tour, and we had such a wonderful following from the people mm-hmm. in San Antonio. In fact, people from all over the Texas came. And we had such, in fact, they said that we were the biggest attendance for the first tour ever in the United States.
Well, congratulations.
So we were so proud.
Yeah. Well, you should be proud. And of course, there are a lot of beautiful gardens that are going to be on tour this year.
Yes.
Before we dive in and start talking about the particulars of the gardens, let's give people the big picture. This is happening on Saturday, October 23rd.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Rain or shine?
Yeah, it's true. From 9 to 5.
9 to 5,
and
okay.
They can buy tickets at any of the gardens for $5 each person. Children are free, 12 and under.
Okay.
Or you can go, there are four places, retail places on the website
okay.
That they can buy day passes. and
all right.
You save $5 if you buy a day pass for $25 for six gardens.
Okay, and I know that lots of people want to buy the whole pass mm-hmm. because they want to see everything
yes.
there is to see.
Yes.
And we have, of course, the website information. It is gardenconservancy.org/opendays, and
right.
they can find all the information there about San Antonio.
Yes, and directions and everything
Perfect.
There.
I know that they'll make it very easy for them. And one of the things I always, whenever we talk about one of the garden tours, I always want to highlight the fact that often you get to, it's more than just seeing the gardens. You get to interact with the designers and the gardeners
yes.
themselves.
Yes, they will be there that day and ready to talk to the visitors. And each garden is good learning tool mm-hmm. for the visitor, and each one is so different that I think it's good if you go around and get around to every one of them.
Well, you've chosen a nice mix, I'll say
mm-hmm.
that, and
mm-hmm.
something for everybody, I think.
Yes, yes,
and
small and big.
Right, and that's the way it should be,
yeah.
you know, from cottage gardens to kind of grandiose
right.
spaces.
Right.
We're going to walk people through some of the different gardens, and we're going to start off by one that we're calling the Bluff Post Garden. And this has some striking features in it, including some rather grandiose statues.
Yes, the Balinese statues that they mm-hmm. brought in by crane into the garden. I wish I could have been there that day to see it, but
mm-hmm.
it must
Gorgeous
have been.
Gorgeous statues.
Yes, they are lovely. And the property is on two lots,
mm-hmm.
so it's on a gradual incline. And they have a beautiful pool tucked in there
mm-hmm.
with a little waterfall
mm-hmm.
and a gazebo and lots of their friends and neighbors come by and just
mm-hmm.
pass beautiful, lots of beautiful times there.
Mm-hmm. Some interesting sitting arrangements here as well,
yes.
the chairs.
Yes, they are. Yes, that's a recent addition since I was able to get their garden. They've added those two chairs, and I must say they're quite comfortable.
Well, it looks like they needed to be brought in with a crane too, though.
Yes, very heavy. You're not going to move those away.
Well, but also there's a kind of a sense of peace about this garden. It's very
it
tropical
is.
And lush.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
And the one of the owners loves to read the garden poems, and he thinks it's very Walden-esque, and so he loves to sit there and read and think in his lovely garden.
Well,
so.
A little touch of Walden in the backyard would be a good thing for all of us, I think.
Absolutely.
So that's the Bluff Post Garden. The next one is we're calling Kellyan Court, which I'm assuming is the address. And this is one that's on a steep lot.
It is very steep. And John Troy and John Moss and Billy Long have been able to construct a beautiful, beautiful place out of it. It is a large estate also, has gorgeous old oak trees
mm-hmm.
all over it. And the team was able to construct a lot of retaining walls,
right.
Rock and concrete and
mm-hmm.
everything. And then in the back, what is really interesting, besides the beautiful pool and all the wonderful walls they've constructed, a century-old building was there on the property. And the owners didn't really, think they could do anything with it. But when the team looked at it and they discovered, the age of it and everything, they wanted to save it. And so they knocked out a few of the walls or some of the rock and then engineered a really fabulous roof onto the top of it. And the owners call it their casita, whether cabana or casita. Mm-hmm. And they sit out there at night and look through the
It's a charming
top.
Looking space.
Yes,
absolutely charming.
See the moon and stars out there,
yeah.
and it's just so lovely.
It's a nice cross between, say, the German farmhouse and
yes.
21st century technology, it looks like.
Absolutely.
And
they left the history there, which is
right.
so wonderful.
Yeah, and I'm sure people will really enjoy that space as well. And
yes.
as you say, a lovely pool with a beautiful water feature on
mm-hmm.
it as well. So another great example of kind of creativity in the San Antonio garden community.
And they have some fruit trees in
mm-hmm.
there and succulents and all of the native plants, of
mm-hmm.
course, tucked in those retaining walls.
Great.
And so It's going to be beautiful.
Okay. The next garden is the clothes garden. And this, the gentleman who is the primary gardener here is a collector. And I kind of get sense of that from some of the images I've seen.
Yes, yes. He he loves to go around to places that are getting rid of bad, you know, supposedly bad plants. Mm-hmm. He brings them back to life. I mean, they're just beautiful. Ferns and all kinds of succulents and everything. And he loves to put them in containers. He has many, many containers. So I guess you could call him a container gardener.
Sure.
And he has, besides that, he's kind of an artsy type. And he has lots of Mexican birdhouses on the back of their house. Mm. And just a lot of interesting things in that garden.
A lot of character. Uh-huh. You can feel the character of the gardener in this one. And, you know, sometimes gardens feel generic. They may be beautiful, but they don't seem particular to anybody. Mm-hmm. This looks like, I bet, a reflection of the gentleman
Absolutely.
Himself.
Absolutely. And places they've gone with their friends and family members, they bring back rocks from those places.
I'm guilty of doing the same
thing. We all kind of slip in one in the car, don't we?
It's difficult in airport security now to explain the rock. But I've tried.
He has a lovely paper that it's kind of like a poem or a paragraph about rocks also that the visitor can look at.
Great.
And it's a lovely story about rocks and stones that he's collected.
Well, I don't know if we're going to get to all the gardens, but I want to make sure we talk about the Cargill garden as well.
Yes,
yes. And this is one that looks like could be here in Austin, a little cottage garden.
Yes, yes. It's typical of the little cottage gardens in Alamo Heights. And the owner wanted a backyard free of grass, no grass. Mm-hmm. We're all trying to get rid of some of that grass, I think, because of the water problems. And it's on a flat surface, limestone rock surface out there. And the owner has, and Richard Thompson has designed it. And and they have four biomes in there, and the plants that are indigenous to those
different
areas.
Regions, right? So people can get a sense of different zones in the garden. And then there's another garden that we're not going to be able to talk about, the Huffman Garden.
Huffman Garden.
Which looks like another really kind of grandiose space, which I know people will enjoy.
Yes.
But again, let's just hit the details. It's going to be happening on the 23rd.
Yes, from 9 to 5.
Okay.
And we have four retail places in San Antonio where you can buy tickets, or you can just go to the gardens and pay $5 per person each.
And the beautiful thing about the Garden Conservancy tours, it goes to support the work of the Conservancy, which is out there trying to save some of the great private gardens of the United States. And there are a lot of magnificent gardens out there that, without the gardeners taking care of them, would just disappear altogether.
That's true. That's right.
And the Conservancy saves those, and I think it's important work.
And the Gardening Volunteers of South Texas are helping with their volunteers, and so they will be there that day. And we appreciate all their help.
Okay, well, we really do appreciate you being with us. Thanks so much for making time to be on Central Texas Garden.
Thank you so much.
All right, coming up next, it's our friend Daphne.
Hello, and welcome to Down to Earth. Today we have a special guest horticulturist. This is Augie Doggy. If you happen to follow me on Twitter, at Daphne Richards, you've seen a lot of tweets about him. He's a new little boy in my life, so we thought we'd bring him in today to meet everyone. Our question this week is from Ava Hayes, who has some very confusing tissue. She didn't understand what it was. It's actually fasciated. We're not sure what causes this tissue. It does look really interesting. It's definitely a genetic mutation, and it develops when the round growing point, the apical meristem, becomes distorted and crescent-shaped. Because of that, the apical meristem no longer is a rounded mass, and the growth becomes flattened. This creates a flattened stem, and it's usually fan shape. This normally occurs in discrete regions of the plant and not all over it. In experiments, this type of growth has been created from an overabundance of plant hormones, wounding, and severe pruning. But still, we really don't know what causes it. Most of these occur in nature, and they have no known cause. It may simply be a genetic anomaly. Genetic mutations that lead to an evolutionary advantage are sustained, but these don't seem to have one. This can be reproduced asexually, and so it's prized in horticulture because it's so interesting. You'll notice a similarity, because it is the same, to our crested saguaros in the Sonoran Desert. In addition to stem tissue, as you see here, the flowers can be distorted. And an example of that is coxcomb celosias, and even beefsteak tomatoes can show this characteristic. You should look at the flowers next time you grow those. Our plant this week is chaparral sage, Salvia clevelandii. This plant has wonderful foliage fragrance, but the flowers are not terribly fragrant. It's evergreen, and the flowers are similar to horse mint. It is a relative. Those flowers occur along elevated stems, and they are much higher than the plant. The flowers are light to medium purple, so plant this near a sidewalk because the smells when you brush against it are really nice. It gets about 3 feet tall and wide, so give it plenty of space, full sun, and very low water. It does tolerate our alkaline soil, and if you want to amend the soil, do it with a sandy soil amendment. It's great in rocky soil, but not too much organic matter, and it doesn't like our clay soils. We are having a lot more decomposed granite landscapes, so these would be great in that situation. You do need to be cautious when you water these plants. They do not tolerate being overwatered. You may have to mail order them. They're not commonly available around here, but they are a plant from the native Southern California. They're not invasive, though. I brought mine back last year, and it did croak in the fall deluge that we got last year, so be very careful where you plant it. To do this week, it's a great time to plant a tree. Here we are in the fall. The nights are staying cooler, and we're getting some nice autumn rain. Deciduous trees are getting ready to go dormant, so it's a perfect time to plant them and let them concentrate on their roots. I know you all know that the planting hole should be much wider than it is deeper, and if you are looking at that, just be sure to not plant your trees too deeply. You want to look for the root flare at the base of the tree, and you want to be that above the soil level. We'd love to hear from you. Please visit klru.org/ctg to send us your question or a plant of the week from your garden.
Thanks, Daphne. Now let's check in with Trisha Shirey for Backyard Basics.
At Lake Austin Spa, we have a long tradition of having pumpkin decorating contests for Halloween, and the grounds department does a little bit different twist. We decorate with natural elements that are growing here in the grounds. Onyx, my black cat here, and I are going to show you around at some of our pumpkins. This pumpkin is decorated with bamboo legs, and the legs are covered with purple fountain grass plumes. The body of the pumpkin has Gulf Muley seed heads, and we've got mountain laurel seed pods, as well as some gourds and some black pearl pepper berries for eyes. So lots of native plants and natural elements used in the pumpkin's face. We use a drill to make the holes where we're going to be putting things like the legs and the eyes. Just makes it easier. And then we use a glue gun and a glue pan to fit those in. And sometimes we use sticks to affix them to the pumpkin. What's nice when you do that kind of thing where you're making small openings in the pumpkin is the pumpkins tend to last a lot longer than if you make large openings in the pumpkin. Here we've taken a pumpkin and decorated it from the side, put another pumpkin in front, used pomegranates for the eyes with black pearl peppers, and we have Esperanza seed pods for the mouth parts and trumpet creeper seed pods for the legs. We did spray paint on the body, and then we used some Peruvian purple and black pearl peppers to make the spots for the ladybug. And a pepper for the mouth. This is our turkey pumpkin. This could take you all the way into Thanksgiving. And we've taken the pumpkin and made some small holes with an electric drill and stuck in some plumes of pampas grass for the wings and the tail. And we also covered the body of the turkey with pampas grass plumes. Then we used celosia for the wattle on the head and underneath. We used peppers for the eyes and gourds for the face. Imagine having this lovely lady gracing your front porch. She's got hair made from Mexican feather grass and purple fountain grass plumes. She's got a lovely headband made with marigolds and mums. And she's got bur oak acorns for eyes, colored in with nail polish. She does have an unfortunate case of warts made from purple and red peppers. And she's got some very interesting dental work. And those are ahi lemon peppers and various Peruvian purple peppers. She has Datura seed pod ears with some Esperanza seed pod earrings. When it's time for you to decorate your next jack-o'-lantern, you might want to take a walk out on the yard first and look at seeds and berries and grass heads and all kinds of wonderful textures and elements in your yard that might be useful for decorating your very unique jack-o'-lantern.
Visit klru.org/ctg to watch online. Until next week, I'll see you in the garden.